From our archives, the Billy Graham Classics.
I found a friend when life seemed not worth living. I found a friend so tender and forgiving. I can't conceive how such a thing could be, that Jesus cared. Each year, my faith in Him is growing. He's ever near, His love is overflowing. I have no fear, my worldly cares are few. I've found a friend, He can be your friend too. And be your friend too. Because He came, my soul will live in glory. I'll praise His name and tell my Savior's story. What friend so true would give it all for you? And life began anew. I'm sure you will find that He'll be your friend too. What a friend we have in Jesus. A friend we have in Him.
Now tonight I want you to turn with me to the 15th chapter of Luke's Gospel. The 15th chapter of Luke's Gospel. And here is where Jesus is telling a story. He tells three stories. He always used stories to illustrate spiritual truth. They're called parables. And everybody likes a good story. And Jesus was accused by the Pharisees and Sadducees and some of the religious leaders of fellowshipping and talking to sinners. And they didn't think you should. And so He told this story. He told about a son that wanted to get his inheritance and leave home. And it's well known around the world as the prodigal son. It's a picture of a young man, maybe out on a farm. He has a brother, an older brother, and he goes to his father, and it was the law of the land, and it was the law of the day, that he could ask for his inheritance. And being the youngest son, he inherited one-third of the estate. And his father was a wealthy man. And the father tried to talk him out of it. He said, "Dad, I'm tired of being here on the farm. I'm tired of being under your authority. I'm going to go to the big city and I'm going to live it up." So he decided that he would go to New York or he would go to some great city. And he took his money. And when he got there, he found some people that were very happy to be his friends because he had money to throw around and money to spend on them. And he took them to the best plays, and he took them to the best restaurants and the best nightclubs, and he had a marvelous time for a short time. The Bible says there's pleasure in sin for a season. Then it comes to an end. You can have a good time in sex, in getting drunk, I'm told. And I see it on television. They seem to be having a good time, but there comes an end to it. There's an emptiness to it. It leaves a void. And you never get enough. And he was very much like young people in our modern generation. They don't want to be told what to do. And that's what young people are saying. Some young people are saying to their parents and teachers and the local police. Some of them are saying, have sex now. Don't wait for marriage. Buy now on credit. Pay later if you can. Assert your independence. Assert your dependence. Do your own thing regardless of the consequences. The Atlanta-based Center for Disease Control says that the number of American girls who are sexually active by the time they're out of high school has jumped from 28% in 1970 to 51% last year. It's currently estimated that 1 in 500 adults in the world are now infected with AIDS. And it's going to be an epidemic that some people feel could destroy the human race unless we find an answer to it, and find it soon. This young man in Jesus' story sets out. He's going to live that kind of life. He wants all that he can get out of life, the good times. Out of sight of anyone who might know and criticize him, free to do as he pleases. There are over 1 million runaways in the United States every year. I realize many left home because of abuse and so forth. A recent article told of a boy who turned to life on the street when he was 12. And he said, I was a kid in trouble. I was in trouble with the law, with drugs, with alcohol, with my mom, with school. I was both drug addict and drug dealer. I was a criminal and a victim. I was an abuser and abused. And how many of our young people have gone to the streets and left home? Street life is a dangerous business, let me tell you. 1 out of every 3 runaways is lured into prostitution within 48 hours of leaving home. With the threat of AIDS, prostitution is a slow form of suicide. Almost all street drug users share needles. In their hunger for a fix, most ignore the precautions against AIDS. Street kids die quickly and quietly, we are told in our magazines. In America, more than 5,000 teenagers a year are buried in unmarked graves. Did you know that? 5,000 teenagers a year are buried in unmarked graves. Teenagers are not the only runaways in our society. Hundreds of thousands of men and women run away from each other and their marriages through divorce. One person speaking of an affluent community in Southern California said, everyone here is running from something, and this is the last stop. There isn't anywhere to go from here. I saw a book with a title the other day in the bookshop, Help Lord, My Whole Life Hurts. And how many hurting people there are here tonight. This prodigal son is a picture of all of us, because all of us in a way are running from something. Some of us have to depend on some sort of sedative just to get through the day, or some sort of jolt, some aid to get through the day or through the night. We've aimed for our personal happiness and missed the mark of God's plan for our lives. Jesus said, you serve me with your lips, but your heart is far from me. Many of you go to church. Most of you, I'd say, have been baptized, or you have gone through confirmation. But deep inside, there's a void, there's an emptiness, and you are not certain that if you died at this moment, you'd go to heaven. You are not sure that you're ready to meet God. You're not sure that you know Christ. You're running. All around us here tonight, those of you that are listening outside, running away from something. This boy squandered his wealth in wild living. He spent it all and had nothing to show for it. In Isaiah, the 55th chapter, it says, why spend money for what is not bread, and your labor on what does not satisfy? Listen to me and eat what is good, and your soul will delight in the richest of fare. Give ear and come to me. Hear me, that your soul may live. When John F. Kennedy was on his way to that place in Dallas to give his last speech the day he was assassinated, he had in his speech this passage from Mark, the 8th chapter. For what shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? In other words, you could have the whole world. It's not worth if you had it all, which you can't get. If you had it all, it's not worth as much as the soul that lives inside your body. You see, you have a body, but living inside is your soul or your spirit, that part of you that can have fellowship with Almighty God. And that's the part of you that's lost. And that's the part of you that needs renewal or dedication or redemption. And then this young man got to the city and had his wild fling. Then a depression came. It wasn't a recession, it was a depression. And let me tell you, I lived through the depression of the 30s, and there's a great difference between a depression and a recession. What we're going through now would have been considered a great affluent depression compared to what the people of the 30s lived through in this country. And a depression could come again, we don't know. The picture of this young man's recognition of his condition. Jesus said he began to be in need. The first thing that happened was he lost his money. He couldn't get a job. He lost his friends. They were fair weather friends. And he didn't know what to do. Jesus says he began to be in need. He was hungry. And so he finally got a job feeding some hogs. And you see him in that hog pen. Here he was, the son of a wealthy man. Out of his own lust and his own greed, he had wandered away from home. And now he has a job feeding pigs. But he, while there in that condition, he learned what the real life is all about. He was very humble. He became sorry. He said, I will arise and go to my father. My father has servants that have far more than I have. I'll go back to my father and I won't be his son anymore. I'll say, Father, when I get there, I'll become a servant if you'll only take me back. He said, I will arise and go to my father. Father, I have sinned against heaven. Notice he said against heaven. And in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be thy son. Here you don't find any trace of arrogance, not trying to justify what he'd done. He realized he had sinned, and he cast himself on the mercy of his Father. In King David's great confession of sin, in Psalm the 51st chapter, 51st Psalm, he says, the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart, O God, thou wilt not despise. Because in this passage, Jesus is teaching us, God is the Father. He loves us. He longs for us to return. He longs for us to come back home. He wants to give you guidance in your life. He wants to give you a peace and joy and assurance that if you died, you'd go to heaven. But first, there must be a change. You must turn around. That's called repentance in the Bible. Repent, the scripture says. And so it says, and he arose and came to his father. He arose. He had to leave the pig pen. And that's why we give an invitation at all of our crusades. We give people an opportunity to take that step of repentance toward God. Many of you need to take that step tonight. Well, when you get back home, what kind of reception are you going to get? He didn't know. So he staggered in his dirty, filthy, smelly clothes back toward the home that he had left. And the scripture says, but when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. God's not waiting to judge you. God's not waiting to condemn you. God loves you. He sent his son to die on the cross for you, to shed his blood for you. He wants to put his arms around you and receive you back to himself. You've wandered away from him. And he will take you and forgive you and love you and be your friend. God is a God of love and mercy. Oh yes, there's coming a judgment, There'll be some day when you will stand before God at the great judgment day, and you'll have to give an account of your life here, and you'll have to give an account of what you did with Jesus Christ on this very night, because there's going to be a judgment. But God's judgment is also tempered by His love and His mercy. He's willing to forgive you tonight. He's willing to give you a chance tonight. Today is a day of grace and salvation for all who will come, not because we deserve it, but because what Christ has done for us on the cross. By the cross and the resurrection, God has provided a way for you to have peace and joy and happiness in your heart. And as you're growing up, you need guidance. You need direction. Not to just wander about, but some destination, something to guide you. God will guide you. In Romans, the 6th chapter, it says, "The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." In 1 Peter, it says, "Who His own self bare our sins in His own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness. For ye were as sheep going astray, but are now returned unto the Shepherd and Bishop of your souls." Now, He didn't come like some young person would probably come back and say, "Hi, Dad, how are you? Did you miss me? Can I have my old room back?" No, He didn't come with that attitude. He came in true repentance. True repentance doesn't presume on the grace and mercy of God. Can only come when the Holy Spirit convicts you and draws you to God. Beware of the attitude that says, "I know that I'm on the wrong road, but I'm not tired of it yet. I'll repent and come back to God somewhere down the line." You may not be able to repent, because the further you travel on the road away from God, the harder your heart gets. And the less you think you've done anything wrong, and the less you think you need to repent, you must make that choice tonight. And the Scripture teaches to come while you're young. Some of you think that you're too bad to come to God, have done too many things and gone too far. If you feel a tug in your heart to make your commitment tonight, you come, because that's the work of the Holy Spirit working on you right now. I don't believe anybody is here tonight by accident. I think you're here because God saw to it that through a series of circumstances, you're here on this very night. The Holy Spirit is at work urging you to come. Don't harden your heart. The Bible says, "He that hardeneth his heart, being often reproved, shall suddenly be cut off, and that without remedy." Now is the time to come. Now is the time to receive. Jesus told the story of this man, this young man, because the religious leaders had accused him of associating with bad people. Jesus told them, "There's great rejoicing in heaven over one person that repents." One person making his commitment tonight will cause rejoicing in heaven. You need to come home to God tonight. When that young man came, his father grabbed him in his arms, kissed him, ordered his servants to prepare a banquet for him, ordered that the finest robe in the house was put on him and a gold ring put on his fingers to signify that he had been received as his son again. He didn't take him back as a servant. He took him as a son. And that's what God will do tonight from you. Our last crusade before this was in Glasgow, Scotland. And here's a letter from Scotland that I want you to hear. This is from a girl. I think she's about 19. No, 18. "Before you came to Glasgow, I was an 18-year-old with a very big chip on my shoulder. I thought God owed me so much. I thought no one loved me. I thought there was no meaning to life. Something was missing in my life. I thought I was having a lot of fun. I was going out with the guys and getting drunk. I hated my family and felt so unloved. To be honest, I still feel unloved. Even by my family, they think I'm just a loser. One of my brothers used to sexually abuse me. The other one beat me up. I feel like I have it rough with very little love in my life before this week. I'm no angel. In fact, I'm a totally awful person. A few months ago, I was expelled from school, and I was blaming drugs. My parents are still mad at me. My dad is a doctor and my mother's a teacher. They say it looks bad on them having a daughter like me. I don't fit in with my family. I heard you were coming to Glasgow and I said I would not go. But where I work, I was told I was assigned to do first aid every night at the crusade. And I was not happy. I went on Tuesday and I mocked you. I laughed at you. I said, what does he know anyway? I said, doesn't he know God does not care for us? But I guess I was listening anyway. On Wednesday, I said, I don't deserve God's love. I never cared if anyone saw me or what anyone thought. I felt loved for the first time. And on Thursday night, I came forward and received Christ as my Savior. I want to know this God who loved me more than anything. I feel loved as I write this letter. I have been received home. That could happen to you tonight. We receive hundreds of letters like that every week, as young and old alike come to Christ. How many divorced people meet at a crusade like this? They come to the crusade, they receive Christ, and they decide to remarry. And that happens time after time after time. You say, well, Billy, what in the world do I have to do? First, repent of sin. That word repent means you change your way of living and tell God that you're sorry for what you've done. And you come in humility. And then the second thing is by faith you receive Him. You say, Lord, I receive You tonight. I talked to a man today. He said, I go to church once in a while. He said, I burn a few candles once in a while. And he said, I think that maybe indicates I'm a good man. I said, you have to go further than that. You have to receive Christ into your heart and your life and make Him first in every decision you make. From now on, Christ is your leader and guide and Savior. He died on the cross and shed His blood to forgive all of your sins. He rose again. He's alive. He's coming back again, and someday He's going to set up His kingdom on this earth. And we're all looking forward to that day, and you can be in that kingdom beginning tonight. You don't have to wait till He comes back. You can come tonight and be sure. And there are many of you here tonight that are just not certain of that. And you'd like to make sure, and you want to surrender your heart and your life to Christ. I'm going to ask you to get up out of your seat from all over the stadium and come and stand in front of the platform. And say, by coming, I receive Christ into my heart. You say, well, why do you ask people to come forward like this? Because every person that Jesus called, He called publicly. Did you know that? Everyone was public. There's something about making a public declaration that settles it and seals it. And you're saying to God and the whole universe, I take my stand for Christ. I receive Him as my Savior and my Lord, and I'm going to follow Him. And if you have been in the church but have wandered away from the church and wandered away from God, come back to Him tonight. He stands with open arms ready to receive you with love and mercy and grace. You get up and come right now, hundreds of you, and say tonight, I want to follow Christ from this moment on.
as these many hundreds here in the arena are responding to the invitation to follow Jesus Christ. You can make that same commitment right now where you are. Just call the number on your screen. Special friends are waiting to talk with you and to pray with you about this most important decision, so don't wait. Make that call now.
There are many of you that are watching by television, and you're not sure that Christ lives in your heart. You're not sure that He's your Lord and your Master and the director of your life. You can make your commitment where you are.
If you just prayed that prayer with my Father, or if you have any questions about a relationship with Jesus Christ, I would just call that number that is on the screen. There'll be someone there to talk with you, pray with you, and answer those questions. And remember, God loves you.
If you would like to commit your life to Jesus Christ, please call us right now toll-free at 1-877-772-4559. That's 1-877-772-4559. Or you can write to us at Billy Graham, 1 Billy Graham Parkway, Department C, Charlotte, North Carolina, 28201. Or you can contact us on the web 24/7 at peacewithgod.tv. We'll get the same helps to you that we give to everyone who responds at the invitation. On behalf of Franklin Graham and the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association, thank you for watching, and thank you for your prayers.
From our archives, the Billy Graham Classics.
I want to take this opportunity to welcome all of you. I want you to turn with me tonight to the 6th chapter of Matthew's Gospel and the 24th verse. The 6th chapter and the 24th verse. These words: "No man can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and materialism at the same time. You have to make a choice. No man can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and materialism." You know, there's a psychological vacuum in America tonight. Millions have no purpose for living and no motivating challenge. They want a cause to believe in. They want a song to sing and they want a flag to follow. Ernest Hemingway once said, "I live in a vacuum that is as lonely as a radio tube when the batteries are dead and there's no current to plug into." Irvin S. Cobb once said, "In politics, I'm a Democrat. In religion, I'm an innocent bystander." I remember a story that they used to tell out of the American Civil War. One man said, "I'm neutral." So he put on gray trousers and a blue coat, and they shot at him from both sides. Christ never allowed people to be bystanders and spectators. The word Christian is from the Latin, and it literally means partisan for Christ. A partisan for Christ. You know, they're having all that trouble down in Yugoslavia, and Mr. Tito died some time ago and left a vacuum in that country, and his people that followed him in fighting the Nazis during the war were called partisans. I'm old enough to remember that myself. And they were called partisans, and they committed themselves. They believed in something. And those partisans never play it neutral. They never play it safe. They never sit on the fence. They are never spectators in the struggle of their times. They take sides. They commit themselves. I heard one in Texas. They asked this man, "Are you a Christian?" He said, "No, thank God, I'm a Baptist." The word Christian in the early days was used in derision. It was a term of reproach. Many people have a wrong idea about what a Christian is. They think that a Christian is a person who prays, who lives by the golden rule, who is sincere, who goes to church, and who keeps the Ten Commandments. All those are good things. They're products, many times, of being a Christian, but that doesn't make you a Christian. That doesn't really make you a true follower of Jesus Christ. A Christian is one that three things has taken place in his life. First, he has made a choice. All the way through the Bible, we're asked to make a choice. Adam and Eve made the wrong choice, and it affected the whole human race because they sinned against God, and that became a disease that went from generation to generation, and you and I have a disease that's going to end in physical death and spiritual death unless we turn to Christ. Every choice we make affects other people. In Deuteronomy, the 30th chapter, Moses called upon the people of Israel, "I call heaven and earth to record this day against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore choose life, that both thou and thy seed may live." Choose. Joshua, the 24th chapter, Joshua said to the people, "Choose you this day whom you're going to serve." I'm asking you tonight to make a choice. Many of you have a choice to make. I talked to a man on the telephone this afternoon, and I asked him straight out, "Will you receive Christ as Savior?" He said, "Not now. I'm going to think it over. I have too many questions to ask." And he made a choice, but he said, "I'll watch on television, and I'm praying that he'll make the right choice." In 1 Kings, the 18th chapter, Elijah said to all the people, "How long are you going to halt between two opinions? If the Lord God be God, follow him. If the devil is God, serve him." Jesus said, "Enter ye in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be that go therein, because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth to life, and few there be that find it." Think of it. Jesus said it's a narrow gate, it's a narrow road for eternal life, and only a few people are going to find it. Most of the people are going to be on the broad road that leads to destruction and judgment and hell. Which road are you on tonight? You have to make that choice before you leave here. And then secondly, a Christian is a person who has made a change in the way you live. The Holy Spirit comes into your life when you receive Christ, and he gives you the power to change your whole way of life. The scripture says, "Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new." Your mind, your emotions, your will are all involved in that change, and it affects your whole life when you come to Christ. Many people have made statements about this very thing. Freud said people change by renewing their fixations. Adler, the great psychiatrist, used to say, people change by renewing their goals. Rollo May used to say, they change by renewing their efforts towards self-realization. But God says people change by renewing their minds. The Bible has a lot to say about the mind. When you come to Jesus Christ, you don't commit intellectual suicide. You come to Christ with your mind, and you change your mind, and that's repentance. You change your mind toward God, you change your mind toward sin, you change your mind toward yourself, and you change your mind toward your neighbor, and you begin to love your neighbor as yourself. The Bible is very clear. To change from a defeated, problem-oriented person depends on first changing the mind, because our problems, emotional upsets and feelings and behavior and goals, are all rooted in wrong basic beliefs about how to meet our personal needs in Christ. The third thing, a Christian is a person who has accepted a challenge. Jesus said, "If any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me." How many of you are looking for a challenge? If any man will come after me, the first thing he must do is deny self, your own selfish ambitions, your own self goals. And you must come to the cross where Christ died for you and shed his blood. Because you see, you and I are sinners. We've all broken God's law and we deserve judgment. We deserve hell. We're going to end up in hell. We're going to end up at the judgment. But Christ came on the cross. And by his stripes we are healed. When they took those long leather thongs with steel pellets and beat him across the back, he was doing that for you. When they put those nails in his hands, he was doing it for you. When they put that spear in his side, he was doing it for you. He went to hell for you. He took your judgment and your hell so that you'll never have to spend 1 minute in hell and you'll never have to face the great judgment of God. That's how much God loves you. God loves you. But he rose again. We don't worship a Christ who's still on a cross. We worship a living Christ. That's what Easter's all about. But God says that if you're to follow him, you're going to have to take up your cross daily. Every morning when you get up, you take up your cross. Now, what is your cross? The cross is the fact that Jesus went out to die on the cross. It was like saying, take up the electric chair and follow me today. Take up the gallows and follow me. You identify yourself with Christ openly and publicly, and you're not ashamed of Christ. That's what it means. He would walk down the street. And he would call men and they would follow him. Now, some young people here tonight resist the idea of choice of any sort. We've been called the generation of the uncommitted. They don't want to be called narrow. They don't want to close their minds. Christ taught clearly that there are two roads, two masters, and two destinies. We cannot travel both roads, so we avoid the choice as long as we can. There's death in every choice. You die to one road when you go down the other. Life never allows neutrality without exacting a price. Try to be neutral in politics, and one day you'll be confronted with the ballot box. Try to be neutral about the race problem, and you'll be confronted in your block, in your neighborhood, or on your street, or in your school. And someday, it will come to you. You can't be non-involved in the issues of our day and the social problems of our day. You can't be involved with the thousands of people that walk the streets of King County with no place to sleep and nothing and very little to eat. We have to do something about it. That's the reason we have Love in Action. We know we can't feed all the hungry people, but we do it as an example as to what churches ought to be doing all the time. We ought to be extending a helping hand to help all of those that are in need. Some people don't want to be involved in their neighbor's problems. There's a time, though, when you must stand up and be counted. Jesus Christ demands that you decide about him. Pilate asked, "What shall I do then with Jesus, which is called Christ?" Pilate washed his hands. You have to make a decision about Christ. Whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And Simon Peter answered and said, "You are Christ, the Son of the living God." Now, some are reluctant to make the choice for Christ because of theology. You don't want to accept all the things that the Scripture teaches about God and about Christ, even about God himself. The Bible says, "I am the Lord God, I change not." The Bible says God is a God of love. And then there comes the Bible. What am I going to do about the Bible? I can't accept the Bible. Job says, "I've esteemed the words of his mouth more than my necessary food." In 2 Timothy, the 3rd chapter, it says, "All scripture is given by inspiration of God." The Bible is the inspired Word of God. I don't ever spend 5 minutes wondering whether this is the Word of God or not. I accepted this by faith years ago, and I've never had a doubt about it since. When you accept it by faith, nothing can move you. There are things I don't understand in the Bible. There are things that are almost apparent contradictions, but they're not. I just accept it as God's word by faith. My problem is not the things I don't understand in the Bible, it's the things I do understand. Things that I do understand that I ought to be doing in obedience to Christ. That's what disturbs me. And then there are a lot of young people that say, well, I've heard about conversion and you want us to be converted. Yes, because Jesus said, except ye be converted and become as little children, you can't see the kingdom of God. What does conversion mean? It just means turn around. I'm going this direction. I turn and I start this direction in my life. That's conversion. Just changing over. That's all it means. Don't make a big thing out of it. But it is a big thing because it depends, your eternity depends on whether you've been really converted or not. You have to be converted inside in your heart, not just the outward things. Many people think you're a good person because you go to church, you've been baptized, or maybe you've been confirmed in your church. But you need to come and reconfirm your confirmation vows. You need to come and reconfirm the baptism vows that you took or the baptism vows that your parents took. You need to come and make Christ real in your own life. And then some refuse Christ because of the church. How many times I hear the word, well, the church is full of hypocrites. Well, there's hypocrites in every area of life. I was born and reared on a dairy farm and we sold milk. And we would distribute the milk to the various customers and we'd get up early in the morning and send our little dairy trucks out and I would milk the cows and sometimes I'd go on the truck. And we had several dairies in our area and so when price of milk got so low, the farmers began to put water in the milk. Now they were hypocrites in the milk business. But that did not mean that they were not some real ones. My father would never stoop to such a thing as that. Now, the one requirement for membership in the church is that you are unworthy to be a member. Christ himself founded the church. The church is made up of sinners that have been saved by the grace of God. There's no such thing as a perfect church. If you find a perfect church and you join it, it becomes imperfect. The church is for fellowship. The church is for strengthening our faith. The church has many things that it can contribute to you. But there's another reason that we sometimes say we don't want to come to Christ. We don't want to pay the price. If you want an education, you'll deny anything to get it. If you want wealth, you'll give up all sorts of things to attain it. Now, God gave the very best He had for you. The scripture says he spared not his own son. The scripture says the world passes away and the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God abides forever. What shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? And then there are other young people that are afraid of being misunderstood and ridiculed, do not want to be in such a small minority. The Bible teaches that there may be persecution, there will be. You will be misunderstood. You will be an outsider in many groups. And peer pressure is so powerful today in the various school levels, whether it's the university or whether it's the high school. The Bible teaches that you may be an outsider and you may have to seek some new friends because one of the things that happens is when you come to Christ, you enter a whole new social world. And you will find that you will have brothers and sisters in every country of the world. It's a great fraternity that we join when we come to Christ. And it may not be just Episcopalians or Baptists or Methodists or Pentecostalists or Presbyterians or Catholic. It may be we just are Christ ones. I've been all over, not all over the world, but many parts of the world. And I've met people that were absolute strangers to me, but the moment we met, we were brothers. You might not be invited to certain parties. You might not be invited to certain things, and you may have to pay a price for a little while till you make new friends among believers. To follow Christ may be costly business. But the Apostle Paul said, "Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution." That's a part of the cost. It's not easy to follow Christ in 1991 in America. It's hard. It costs something. And then there are many young people that just put it off. You say, "I'm going to wait till another time." Proverbs 27 says, "Boast not thyself of tomorrow, for you know not what a day will bring forth." The scripture says, "Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation." In Lillian Roth's story in her book, I'll Cry Tomorrow, at a certain point she had this to say, "I'm an alcoholic and I need help." You need to say tonight, "I have sinned against God and I need help. I want to know I'm going to heaven. I want to know my sins are forgiven. I want to be sure if I died now that I would go straight into heaven." Will you say that tonight? And if you're not certain of your relationship to Christ tonight, I'm going to ask you to make sure so that you can leave here and say, "I know that Christ lives inside of me." And I'm going to ask you in a moment to get up out of your seat and say that. You must make that commitment. Don't sit on the fence any longer. Just stand out and say, "I'm coming." A young man recovering from a motorcycle accident in which he nearly died saw that we were going to be in Sheffield, England for a crusade. And he said, "I don't know anything about God, but I ought to hear that man." So he came. He did, and he accepted Christ, and he told his counselor, "I almost died without faith." When we went one of the places, I forget, some city, there was a 16-year-old girl that gave her life to Christ, and the next night she found her counselor and said, "I want to give you a change of address. I'm going back to live with my parents. They came here tonight and we were reconciled." George Williams, who founded the YMCA, came to Christ in the 19th century in England's West Country, and he wrote this, "I cannot describe to you the joy and the peace which flowed into my soul when first I saw that the Lord Jesus had died for my sins and that they were all forgiven." Do you know Christ? Are you certain of it? If there's a doubt in your heart and mind, make sure tonight. I read the life story some years ago of Francisco Pizarro. It brought back to mind today when I was reading about the trouble they're having in Peru. In the 16th century, he conquered Peru. In the midst of great difficulties, when he only had a handful of men left, he drew a line with his sword on the ground. One way was to Peru with riches and danger, and the other was back toward Panama where their ships were and security. He chose to march south to Peru and became the founder of that great nation. Tonight, you stand at the crossroads of your life. You step across that line that has been drawn in the sand by our Lord Jesus Christ. And he says, "Repent of your sin. Be converted. Come to me. I will change your life. I'll make you a new person. I'll give you new power, a new joy, a new peace, a new happiness." I'm going to ask you to come. And by coming, you're saying, "I open my heart and give my life to Christ. I want a change in my life." Get up and come. I'm going to ask that no one leave, please.
As hundreds are coming forward to respond to Mr. Graham's invitation to make a commitment to Jesus Christ, you can make that same commitment right where you are. Just pick up the phone and call the number you see on your screen. Special friends are waiting to talk with you and to pray with you about this most important decision, so please don't wait. Make that call now. The line is busy. Write the number down and call again later.
I want to say a word to you that have been watching by television. You have been here in Seattle, Washington, with us in this great King Dome, one of the great stadiums of the world. And we've seen hundreds of people come to Christ tonight, simply not knowing all about it, but coming to offer themselves to Jesus Christ and praying and hoping that there'll be a change in their lives. There will be, with Christ in their lives. You can make that same commitment where you are. You make the commitment now and say yes to Christ. He'll come into your heart and say, Lord, I want a change to take place in me, in the relations with my family, my wife, my husband, my children, my parents. I need you, Lord, and I want you to come in. He'll forgive your sin. He'll give you the assurance that you're going to heaven when you die. Give your life to Him tonight.
If you just prayed that prayer with my Father, or if you have any questions about a relationship with Jesus Christ, I would just call that number that is on the screen. There'll be someone there to talk with you, pray with you, and answer those questions. And remember, God loves you.
If you would like to commit your life to Jesus Christ, please call us right now toll-free at 1-877-772-4559. That's 1-877-772-4559. Or you can write to us at Billy Graham, 1 Billy Graham Parkway, Department C, Charlotte, North Carolina, 28201. Or you can contact us on the web 24/7 at peacewithgod.tv. We'll get the same helps to you that we give to everyone who responds at the invitation. On behalf of Franklin Graham and the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association, thank you for watching, and thank you for your prayers.
I know many people that have tried everything in life, and they have not found satisfaction. Inward peace, joy, assurance, and security. And they're still searching. You'll never find peace and joy and happiness until you yield your life to Christ. You never will. You have a moment right now. The Bible says now is the accepted time. Today is the day of salvation. People are searching for the answers. You must make the choice. It's urgent. We're to wait for the coming of Christ with patience. We're to watch with anticipation. Scripture says Christ is coming when you're least expecting Him. Coming as a thief. He said, be prepared. Get ready. Prepare to meet thy God. Are you prepared?
You're invited on a journey of discovery at the Billy Graham Library. Retrace Billy Graham's path from humble farm boy to international ambassador of God's love through multimedia, photos, and memorabilia.
But the fruit of the Spirit is love. That is a supernatural.
Tour the restored Graham family home place, browse Ruth's Attic Bookstore, and have a meal at the Graham Brothers Dairy Bar. Enjoy special exhibits.